All right, let's get right into House Bill 65. What we're going to do is, this is a hearing. We're going to go ahead and split the time evenly. I've been in touch with the author. I think the author will take a few minutes to set the table for consideration of the bill and the work of the Medical Cannabis Study Group, working group. After that, there are some witnesses that I know the author has lined up who will go ahead and present their statements. I've asked the author to ask them to please limit their statements to about 5 minutes, simply because what we have found is really through the Q&A, members really benefit by that. That's not to say that a statement is not helpful. It is. But members have specific questions, probably about specific conditions, where they may not have subject matter expertise, certainly. And that's where I think they will be, members will go ahead and garner the most benefit. After that hour is up, then we'll have the opponent's side, and it'll be the same admonition. We have a few people who have been in contact with our office who are ready to go, and we'll ask them to stick to 5 minutes as well, again, to allow for questions. We are going to go ahead and be on a timer. We're not going to cut off somebody mid-sentence, but if you get up to your 5 minutes, your 5 minute limitation, we will gently prod you to wind up so we can go ahead and get to members' questions. So with that, let me go ahead and recognize the author, Representative Alan Peete, also the chairman of the Medical Cannabis Working Group, for his comments on his House Bill 65.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Just so we all know, this is what we're talking about, medical cannabis oil. This is what we're dealing with today. And I thought it might be best to start off real quick, and I'm going to go through this very quickly, to talk about what this bill does not do. First, that might be the best thing. It does not allow growing or cultivation of marijuana in Georgia. It does not change the THC limit of 5% that this body voted on 2 years ago. It does not allow for the smoking of marijuana for medicinal purposes. It is still only dealing with medical cannabis oil. And it builds on a law that was crafted actually by this committee. Many of you who were on that committee 2 years ago, and with significant input from Chairman Golick, the substance of HB1, Habeas Hope Act, was formed in this committee. And it set up the low THC oil registry with the Department of Public Health. It's been a very successful program to date, with over 1,300 patients registered, with over 300 doctors signed up. It has not become a public health risk. Medical cannabis oil has not become a public health risk in the 2 years the law has been in place. It has not become a public safety issue. It has not led to DUIs for being under the influence of low THC oil. It has been a very successful program from all accounts. Now, there is still a gaping hole in our law. How do you access the product? How do you get this here to Georgia in the hands of citizens that are properly registered? And that needs to be addressed one day, but not today. So what the bill does is the following. It adds, and we're working off sub, Mr. Chairman, I believe y'all should have LC 297444S, I believe. And we've made a little bit of changes, so there's a committee substitute from what was originally introduced. It adds 8 conditions to the current law. Currently there are eight conditions from Haley's Hope Act. This adds 8 conditions to the current law. Autism, Alzheimer's, AIDS, Tourette syndrome, PTSD, epidermis malosis, bullosa, autoimmune disease, and peripheral neuropathy. Second thing it does, it removes the end-stage qualification from 5 current conditions that are already included in current law: cancer, ALS, MS, Parkinson's, and sickle cell disease. And you'll hear some testimony from folks today that this has been done at the request of doctors and patients. It removes the 1-year residency requirement. There was a concern, this was added in the Senate, on HB1, concerned that we'd have an influx of people coming to our state because we now allow legal possession of medical cannabis oil. That has not been an issue at all. And it removes the quarterly reporting requirements for physicians at their request. And you should have in your folder, I believe, 2 letters from 2 prominent doctors in our community who both treat a lot of the patients and basically begging us to remove that reporting requirement. Overly burdensome, overly regulatory obligation on their part. The Medical Cannabis Working Group has met and made the following recommendations that have been implemented in the bill. And there were three items. One is reciprocity with other states that have medical cannabis programs for possession of what is allowed under Georgia law. So someone, let's say, someone with a special needs child has a medical cannabis card in another state. They want to come visit their grandparents here in Georgia. The language we have would allow them, if they have properly registered in another state, have the right to legally possess what is allowed only in Georgia law. So they would have the right to be able to possess this product right here if they were properly registered in another state. Secondly, it allows allowance of patients in a hospice program to participate in the registry. Those who are basically in a terminal illness situation would be allowed to participate in the registry, and therefore allowed to be able to possess medical cannabis oil. And third, requires reporting from patients regarding dosage, side effects, and drug interaction upon renewal of registration. We do want to gather some data of what's been going on with folks who have been using this product. And so when a patient who is properly registered signs up for renewal, they would be required to provide information to the Department of Public Health of dosage, of interaction with other drugs, and side effects as well. This is an expansion of what has been so far a very successful program, allowing more hurting Georgians with debilitating illnesses to benefit from the medical cannabis oil. This is the proper next step. One final thought for you. The Medical Cannabis Group made one final recommendation based on the fact that we clearly have an opioid epidemic in our state. If we really want to deal with the opioid crisis in our state, then we must pass reasonable and practical medical cannabis legislation, because there is clear and compelling evidence that will be presented in just a moment that states that have access to medical cannabis in their state see, one, a decrease in the usage of opioids, resulting in significant cost savings to the state in Medicaid and Medicare. Two, a decrease in the abuse of opioids. And third, and most importantly, there is a significant decrease in lives lost from opioid overdoses. There is a proven response with clear data to the opioid epidemic, and that's responsible medical cannabis legislation. Mr. Chairman, I'll answer your questions, and we can go on to the other testimony. I'll leave it up to.
I know we're going to have some. We have some medical subject matter experts. Is that correct? Is that correct?
That's correct. We have a professor from the University of Georgia, right, and several physicians.
Then maybe we'll hold on the condition-specific questions. Members can ask whoever, whatever they want. Maybe those questions are better saved for the medical professionals. Just a couple of things about the underlying bill, as far as basically the mandate on to allow for those individuals who are in a hospice program, the assumption is that those are patients in a terminal condition, correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Is that, I mean, I assume in a hospice program, does that, by definition, if we've done any research in terms of how broad would that be in terms of, if you're in a hospice program, by definition, does that mean a terminal condition or not?
For the most part, yes. Ms. Travis can chime in too, but we could not list it as a condition because you don't have hospice. you right. would be in a hospice program, and so that's how we allowed a patient to be able to register if they were. They still would have to have a doctor do it for them, but they would have to certify that they are in a hospice program.
Okay. And we can flesh that out. I have constituent communication about that. It just seemed to me to make all the sense in the world, just provided we can go ahead and roadmap it, and just to verify that that is in fact the case. That just seems to be intuitively obvious conclusion. Just in terms of the out-of-state piece and coming in, there's the issue that comes into mind about establishing confidence that there's proper rigor, for lack of a better term, in the other state's program than coming in here. Just, it might be a concern regarding the ease to which a card can be obtained in another state as opposed to here in Georgia. That's not by way of criticism of state X, but just seeing that as a possibility in the future, depending on what rigor the other state may or may not have.
I'll give you an idea. This is what the registration card looks like. It's issued by the state of Georgia. I would imagine, and the ones that I've seen from some other states are very similar to this, so there is some security in that card. But I understand the question. And
you know, I mean, it's, what do you have to do to get the card in the state of wherever as opposed to here?
Right.
And to comparing those relative, you know, processes and how tight are they or not.
Right.
Just something to think
about. That'd be worth checking out.
Yeah. It's something just for us to collectively put in the back of our heads as a potential issue to go ahead and flesh out. Members of the committee, for the author. Seeing none, I'll just turn it over to you, whoever you want to call on first.
Mr. Chairman, we had testimony in the medical cannabis working group from a pediatrician in Augusta. It was really compelling about regarding autism. Mm-hmm. She could not attend today, and so, but we did, we had about a minute and a half clip of her testimony, and with your permission, we'd like to share that.
Yes, sir.
I believe Brent, if he's here.
You as a pediatrician, just having your child out at the moment, you would not recommend this for your patient at whatever level it was, either moderate or severe. Is that, am I hearing you correct?
You're hearing me correct in that the more mildly autistic individuals that are doing very well, they're able to function in school, they're not having any other of what we consider autistic, more severely autistic behaviors. They would want to do ABA therapy. They would want to do other things because you never start with medicine, right? You start with therapy. You start with integration. You start with this. The children who need the medical cannabis, they've already done that. They've already tried that. That's mainstream. That's scientific. We know that works.
So are you concerned then if we, if autism was a qualifying condition, that all of a sudden we would have 10,000 kids taking medical cannabis, or is that a concern of yours at all?
It's not because I have a good relationship with my parents. And so they come to me and they say, it'd be just like saying, this is just a out there comparison, but like I go back to, hey, listen, Dr. Ward, I just really want to, you know, calm you down or sit down, but I just really want to calm you down. Can you prescribe like 100 milligrams of Valium today for me? No, I can't do that because I don't think it's in his best interest, right? But I will prescribe Valium for kids who are trying to get a procedure done because ultimately that can happen to them. So as a physician, that doesn't bother me at all. And they're going to come to me and they're going to say, what do you think about this? That's my role as a physician, to tell them what I think. Does that help?
Yeah, question. Thank you for your testimony today. Let me just be very clear. So you, as a board-certified pediatrician, have no hesitation whatsoever in recommending medical cannabis oil as an option for not only your son, but for other patients who are under your care who have autism.
That's absolutely true.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you being here. Thank you for making the time.
Chairman, just what we wanted to emphasize was here we have a respected pediatrician who was providing a, while there are some concerns, and you're going to hear them today about including autism on the list, here's one pediatrician, very well respected, whose son actually has autism, and who is providing that as an option for him. Just thought it would be worth the committee hearing that.
Thank you. Mr. Sessler?
Okay, Mr. Chairman, what we've got Dr. David Bradford, who is from the University of Georgia, very respected the chair of public policy there at the University of Georgia, has a quick report slide. I think you have a slide presentation. He presented at the, come on up, Dr. Bradford. He presented at the medical.
This is Dr. Bradford, is that right?
This is Dr. Bradford, yes.
Okay.
He presented at the medical cannabis working group. It was really some good information, so I thought it would be prudent for him to provide some testimony today as well, too.
That's fine, Dr. Bradford, you're going to be under the 5-minute rule, values.
I will breeze through as rapidly as I can.
Okay.
I'll skip over some of the slides that would normally be on it. So if I go through things quickly, that's in order to meet the rule. Is the presentation loaded?
We just want to leave enough time for Q and A after.
Sure.
So thank you very much for your for the opportunity to come and present to you today. As I said, I'm going to talk to you about three strands of work that I and my co-author Ashley and also some other colleagues at the University of Georgia have done. So I'm going to breeze through some of these quickly because there are a couple of maps that I definitely want you guys to see just when we get to the opiate death problem.
Dr. Bradford, you can go ahead and submit this to members, copies to members of the committee electronically or otherwise.
Okay,
so
great.
If there's something you just can't get through for purposes of time, we can still receive it. It's not an all or nothing proposition.
No problem. So
okay,
I'm going to assume that because so I'm going to skip over the things that I think you guys can just look at. So I did want to bring a couple of things in without getting into too much preliminary about the background. You guys should know, obviously, about the background of medical cannabis. One of the things that I do want to point out in the Controlled Substances Act, as administered by the DEA, currently it's under Schedule 1, as you know, which restricts its access nearly completely, along with heroin, LSD, and a variety of others. And one of the primary reasons for that is that there's not a currently accepted medical use, according to the DEA definitions, for medical cannabis. Nonetheless, we've had 28 states and the District of Columbia who've approved various forms of medical cannabis. These states in green, see at the bottom, are whole plant cannabis. Georgia, 2015, as you were yourselves intimately part of, approved CBD oil, which is another 12 or 14 states have that in place. I did want to draw your attention, though, to some very recent developments. In the middle of January, the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine issued a report that's an authoritative report on the state of knowledge about cannabis with regard to medical treatments. And as part of that report, I'm just going to go through one, they have found conclusive evidence that cannabis is an effective therapy for pain, for spasticity, and also some significant evidence that it is an effective evidence for sleep disorders. There's a variety of other things that you guys can go through the slides and slide deck and see. But the primary thing that I want to bring your attention to is as you're thinking about Georgia's policy, if at least the federal government follows the letter of the law under the Controlled Substances Act, we now have an authoritative voice in the clinical community saying that there is, in fact, evidence for the clinical benefit of cannabis, and so we would expect a rescheduling would be forthcoming. Now, let me just tell you very briefly about three areas of research. And did you want to ask a question? Yeah.
I really do, but that wouldn't be fair. So you go ahead.
Okay.
I'll ask you when.
Okay, sure. So I want to tell you about three areas of research that I've done with colleagues at the University of Georgia, and these involve the impact of medical marijuana laws on the use of medicine, prescription drugs in this particular case. So one of the things that researchers have yet to really ask, and our work is actually some of the first in the country to do this, is to what degree do people appear to treat cannabis as if it's medicine? That is, when you make it available to patients to use as medicine, do they change the use of other medications, particularly opiates, as we'll come back to in the end. And so my co-author Ashley and I had a paper published this past summer in the journal Health Affairs where we took a look at all Medicare Part D prescribing. That's the prescription drug benefit for elderly Americans, and asked what happens to the use of prescription drugs when states turn on medical marijuana laws. We looked at data from 2010 for this paper to 2014. I'm going to show you some results through 2014 to today. And ultimately, just to jump to the end, what we found, you can't really see it very easily here, is that there are very large reductions in the use of prescription drugs in those clinical areas where cannabis is thought to be an effective treatment. You don't see that in areas where cannabis isn't thought to be an effective treatment. And we see something, if for states that have dispensary-based mechanisms, we see something like 2,300 fewer daily doses of pain medications written per doctor per year in those states, and a substantial portion of these are opiates, which I'll come back to very quickly in just a minute. Ultimately, if we think about what impact that means, is that nationally, in 2014, if all states had turned on a medical cannabis law, we would have seen over $1 billion reduction in spending under Medicare Part D, a significant, that's about a 1% reduction in Part D spending, most, the largest portion of which are from pain medication, suggesting that people are using cannabis as medicine, and also suggesting that there are significant cost savings. We redid the analysis, and this is actually in its final stages of approval, also at Health Affairs at the moment, looking at Medicaid, which is the state program for low-income people, and we found exactly the same results. I want to bring you to the end point of that, is which is that, you know, nationally we save about $1 billion in fee-for-service Medicaid. For Georgia, what that meant, it would be about a $13 million per year savings in 2014 if we'd had a cannabis law. And if you take into account that most of our spending on Medicaid is managed care, actually that would be upwards of $36 million if we extrapolated it to the total program. Now, the one thing that I also want to make sure that I touch on is the impact of medical cannabis on opiate deaths. Nationally, you know this is a big problem. About 33,000 people in 2015 died from opiate deaths. Here you see how the bars here represent death rates, and you see how it's shifting to the right, which means shifting to higher and higher levels of deaths. Nationally, now, it's about 2 747s per week crashing every week, people who die from opiates. In Georgia, you'll be able to see, I'm happy that I can show you these animations, took me a while to get going. In Georgia, you can see as it gets darker and darker as we move from 2000 to 2014, this is the death rate from opiates in Georgia. It's an increasing problem here, just as it is nationally, and certainly there are pockets of very intensive opiate death rates that we see in the state. Now, what did we find? We looked at opiate death rates nationally. We looked at what happened when you turned on medical marijuana laws, particularly dispensary-based laws. And what we found was there were significant reductions in death. Medical cannabis laws saved lives at a rather substantial clip. And so I see that you've been indulging with me. I've run over time, but let me just close by saying that the evidence suggests that appropriately designed medical cannabis laws can save lives and money. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bracker. Just to mean, you had mentioned earlier that you were anticipating, I think what you said is you anticipated a rescheduling. But I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think I heard that correctly, but did the FDA last year elect to not reschedule?
In this past summer, the DEA technically was the one in charge of the rescheduling decision with input from the FDA. And this summer, they left the scheduling as it stands, with the reference to the fact that there was still, in their view, no medical consensus on at least an accepted medical use. That's the reason I wanted to bring to your attention the National Academies of Sciences report. They're the, I would think it's fair to say, the authoritative voice for medicine and science in the world. And that report only came out about 4 weeks ago. So the DEA did not have the benefit of those conclusions when they made the decision this summer. And there are a number of bills before the National Congress that would, in fact, reschedule marijuana on the basis of this.
Questions from members of the committee? Ms. Quinn?
No, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Gravely.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Doctor. From your last testimony, I've had an article, several articles of the publications that we receive as legislators, one noting that 90% of new heroin users made their way to heroin via prescription opioids. Another one I found from that time is the data that says people addicted to prescription opioids are 40 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. And so what in finding those, that data that tends to just be coming to us in large amounts, and I know your testimony was speedy, but I want to make sure to be clear, I get for the record for the committee and for those in attendance, the data shows to be very, very clear that states who have, or states with medical marijuana laws have seen a tremendous decrease in opioid usage, opioid deaths, and lives are being saved, and it's a tremendous cost savings. Is that correct?
That's correct. Absolutely, we see very strong evidence that that medical cannabis laws are associated with lower levels of opiate deaths. Not only our work, but other work that's been published recently in the New England Journal of Medicine has shown that at the state level as well. We're saving lives, abuse is going down. And as far as the cost savings go, just from what we can see from Medicare and Medicaid only, without looking at third-party payers like Blue Cross Blue Shield, when you turn on medical cannabis laws, we have the potential of saving above $3 billion a year, which in these tight budgetary times is not trivial money.
Nothing with a B behind it, I would consider to be trivial money. In closing, Mr. Chairman, if I may, according to the CDC, each day almost 7,000 people are treated in emergency departments for using opioids in a manner other than as directed.
That's correct. And we're seeing something on the order of 600 per week dying from it. And as you pointed out earlier, you know, we're looking right now at the consequences largely of prescription opioids leading to heroin and both of those leading to deaths. We haven't even really begun to see the crest of the wave from the fentanyl epidemic, which is incredibly problematic. A million doses of fentanyl can be transported in something not much bigger than a shoebox. So this is one that we have to divert people from opiate use. And any tool that we have in our arsenal that is reasonable to use, and cannabis has never been found to be the primary cause of any death in the clinical literature, any tool that we can use to divert people from opiates diverts people from the path to abuse and death.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Dr.
Ms. Silcox.
My understanding is, I think your study showed, of course, that there would be the savings, but my understanding is that cannabis does have a longer effect on people than opiates do. Opiates are out of your system within the day that you take them, within the hour, I guess the hours, every 6 hours, is my understanding. Whereas cannabis stays in your system for up to 4 to 5 days, correct? So that it's logical to me that if you take the cannabis instead of the opiates, that you would save money because you don't have to take it as frequently, correct?
Well, first off, let me stipulate that I'm an economist, and I do think that there are some clinicians who could perhaps discuss the biomechanics of cannabis much better than I could. It's true that it stays in your system longer. I will say that some work that I have done to look at the cost suggests that if you were just at paying completely out of pocket, that the cost based on clinical trials to treat chronic pain, moderate chronic pain with cannabis would be something in the order of $6 to $7 per day, whereas the cost of oxycodone is something in the order of $9 per day, at least using Medicare prices. So it's very cost-effective intervention for sure. I can say that as an economist, at least.
That's all the questions.
Mr. Sutton. Okay, Mr. Chairman, Dr. Bradford, thanks for being here today. Is it true that as I was listening to your presentation about looking at the kind of the expansion proliferation of medical cannabis in many cases, and you showed the states, we're talking about whole plant. We're able to smoke it and use other means to consume it as opposed to just the low THC oil we're talking about. Isn't it true that the states where you're seeing opioid use go down are the states where you've got a much more robust or much more permissible cannabis law? It's I mean, people are not, isn't it true, supplanting opioids for low THC oil?
That's an excellent question. The research that we did were classifying states based on mostly whole plant cannabis. Now, we'll say there are some variations, but of course, state policy analysis is complicated. New York, for example, does not permit smoking, though it does permit other means of delivery for whole plant cannabis. There is not as much work that has been done looking at low THC cannabis oil, just because that's a relatively recent phenomenon, as you saw on that slide. If you'd like, if you went back and took a look at it, most of the states that have turned that on have done so fairly recently, 2014 and on. And sadly, our data just takes a lag from when we can get it, so we don't know the effect of that yet.
I appreciate that. And Mr. Chairman, I asked the question to members of the committee. I mean, I don't think anyone would dispute that when marijuana becomes legal to be used as a drug of choice for people, there's going to be less use or abuse of opioids. I don't think anyone would dispute that. The question is, in the four corners of this bill, we're talking about low THC oil. And is low THC oil a substitute for opioids that's going to affect opioid use? And that's really the question for this committee. And I think they're dramatically different issues. And I say that, Mr. Chairman, and I say that to Dr. Bradford, and I do have one more question for you. I think there's a real issue, I've seen it across the board, to kind of use the opioid epidemic as a
sort of a cause celeb to build support around medical cannabis or the legalization thereof. But there's a complete disconnect of low THC oil and seeing reduction in opioid abuse. There's just no connection there. That when it's able to supplant opioids as a drug of choice, then you've got stats to support that. But the four corners of this bill do nothing to do that, Mr. Chairman. And I want to be clear about that. I think we're going to hear a lot more people in this discussion talk about opioid abuse is so bad, let's join on to this bill to solve the opioid epidemic. But that little bottle of low THC oil does nothing to address the opioid issue. It's a very different question in states where the quasi-recreational use or the medical proliferation of full whole plant THC is being used. That's where you start to see the downtick. That's not me contemplating here, Mr. Chairman. I do have one more question, if I could. This bill, we're talking about low THC oil. I don't know if you've got any opinions around the particular conditions here. Or do you have any studies that show the specific issue of autism spectrum disorder, PTSD, outpatient use for hospice? Do you have anything to share with the committee on those particular issues that are before us?
With respect, I would refer the committee. Actually, I think it's not an extremely technical read. It's really interesting to get that report from the National Academies of Sciences. They do cover all of that, and I think they do it extremely well. I will say that there is evidence with regard to PTSD and anxiety disorders, the whole spectrum of anxiety disorders with regard to cannabinoids. Now, as an economist, I shouldn't talk about the pharmacokinetics of cannabinoids, THC versus CBD, and I'll leave that to other people. But whole plant cannabinoids, yes, there is evidence.
Has your economics shown that the Mexican drug cartels, which were formerly as really very, very substantial supplier of marijuana to this country before it started to become legalized by the states. Could you speak to how the Mexican drug cartels who used to make their living on marijuana have now shifted to opioids? Because we've taken marijuana, we're growing it in this country, so they've just decided, you know what, let's use opioids as our revenue source. Has your studies demonstrated the irrefutable evidence that's happening now?
Well, irrefutable is a hard phrase for me as an economist to embrace. I will say that I think your broad characterization that as states have approved medical cannabis, that has removed one aspect of cannabis consumption from the black market to the regular market, and it's become a very large market in many states who've done that. That has, as an economist, I would say, had implications for the profitability of illegal drug cartels, whatever their origins. Other things like the ability to synthesize illegally, or at least get your hands on active pharmaceutical ingredients, perhaps Indian or Chinese plants, of fentanyl is perhaps even more problematic because, again, that can be transported with very low cost. Just so much can be fit into a small space. It's orders of magnitude cheaper to transport than marijuana, many orders of magnitude cheaper, and orders of magnitude cheaper to do that than heroin. So I do think that the dynamics of the illegal drug trade are very much in flux. To the extent that we take marijuana, and again, I'm speaking only of medical cannabis. I have not done research on recreational. To the extent you take marijuana out of their hands, you remove a profit center from them.
Thank you, Dr. Brett.
All right, thank you
for your appearance here today. And members, Dr. Brett's presentation is in your member file. They've got it in the file. I mean, it's physically right. I didn't realize it until I saw it. Ms. Pink, you want to, wherever you want to have next? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, committee members, thank you for allowing me to speak. My name is Dr. Ben Rower. I am the medical director of the Andrew C. Carlos MS Institute at Shepherd Center here in Atlanta. We currently care for about 3,000 people with multiple sclerosis. And what I'd like to speak about is the current language in the 2015 bill label requiring that people with multiple sclerosis in the registry have severe or end-stage multiple sclerosis. I guess I'll give you a bit of background first, just if you're not familiar with MS, it is the leading cause of non-traumatic disability in young American adults. We've made great advances in the management of multiple sclerosis. We now have 16 FDA-approved treatments to alter the long-term course of MS. And even though we've made these great strides, we still are left with dealing with the symptoms of MS. Two of the more bothersome symptoms of which would sort of fall under the purview of the CBD oil, and that would be spasticity / spasms and painful dysesthesias or central neuropathic pain, sort of hypersensitive skin, sunburned sort of sensation. The problem that we have with the language requiring that people have severe or end-stage MS, there are several issues with that. The American Academy of Neurology has done a retroactive analysis of the data looking at cannabinoids in the management of various symptoms with MS and concluded that they are clinically effective in both spasticity management, central neuropathic pain, and in lessening frequent urination. In those studies, there was no language requiring the patient to have severe or end-stage multiple sclerosis. The nature of that term end stage is somewhat contradictory as it relates to MS, in that people with MS don't typically die from multiple sclerosis. People with MS tend to die of heart disease, cancer, and stroke, just like the rest of the population. So most of our individuals with MS have a normal life expectancy. The label of severe MS is also somewhat problematic, and then in the medical community, we don't know what that means. So do you mean severe spasticity? Do you mean severe disability in whatever way you manage that? So in the treatment algorithm for managing spasticity or pain in multiple sclerosis, I think the pediatrician that was on tape said it well in reference to autism. You have a treatment algorithm where you start with the least offensive treatments. For us in spasticity management and multiple sclerosis, it would be treating things like an underlying infection or a poorly fitted wheelchair. And then we go up to physical therapy, range of motion, and then we go to medications. We look at CBD oil as that third tier or medication management. One of the problems we have with standard FDA-approved treatment options, prescription drugs for spasticity management and for pain management, is that so many of our treatment options are very sedating. So everything that we look at, we have to discuss a risk and benefit ratio. The CBD oil, the way that I explain it to patients, is that it is a tool in the toolbox. It is not a cure. It is not a miracle drug. It has a risk-benefit ratio like anything else, but it's always nice to have one more treatment option for managing pain and spasticity and multiple sclerosis. And with that, I think I get in under 5 minutes, and I will turn it over to questions.
Thank you. I appreciate your testimony and giving us some perspective on the specifics of multiple sclerosis. That's very helpful. Mr. Rattler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To the, if I may address a point, or at least the questioning for Representative Setzler, in talking about the 4 points of this bill being a CBD oil, low THC oil-based bill, although we are not like other states with full plant access. It's my understanding, and maybe some of the folks in the room, maybe that are aligned to testify, I don't know who they are, but can attest that before treating with low THC cannabis oil, or even CBD only oil, the only option they had was to treat with opioid-based medication. Sometimes maybe even 4 or 5 different prescriptions on children as young as 2, 3, 4 years old, adult dosages or adult titrations. So I think it very much is in line with this bill that we have here, specifically dealing with, if we're talking about and looking at the data in regard to addiction that opioids, the increasing addiction of opioids, and now we have families in the state of Georgia who are now able to take their loved one, their child, or themselves off of that opioid regimen and treat with the low CBD, low THC oil that we have. So I think that would very much address, if I'm not incorrect.
I think we've definitely seen that in the multiple sclerosis community, whereas some of the polypharmacy that we see where some of the medications like baclofen and tizanidine, that many of our patients are on high doses of a combination of those drugs. Both of those drugs, while they're not addictive and they're not opioids, they're very sedating for people. And one of our goals at Shepherd Center or at any MS center in the state of Georgia is to keep people fully functional, keep them in the workplace. It's hard to work, you know, an 8-hour day if you're nodding off at your desk due to the side effects of you know, some of our other medications. We have seen, anecdotally, I've seen less opioid use in our patients for more for central neuropathic pain. Opioids are not typically used for spasticity, but they're definitely used for central neuropathic pain and multiple sclerosis. And I think having the option of the CBD oil, anecdotally, has with a study, but has led to less opioid prescriptions.
And very quickly follow up, Mr. Chairman. I think you answered my follow-up question was what has been the experience with your patients? Just let us know.
Just to finish up, when we talk about CBD oil to our patients, I also relate to them that my experience has been we usually see one of two outcomes. Patients are generally happy with it. They have some degree of symptom control. I have honestly not seen significant side effects. I've not seen sedation. The only side effect I've consistently heard from some people is just the taste is not great. It is certainly not worth for every individual. None of our prescription treatments work for every individual. Ms. Silcox.
With respect to the cannabis oil, do you find that this cannabis oil is addictive?
I do not. So if you look at the Academy of Neurology's position paper, they looked at both the risks and the benefits, and there was not seen, with the CBD oil, there was not seen to be any addictive potential. I would say that anecdotally, if my experience has been, if I had an individual who maybe was using whole plant product recreationally, and we move them over to a CBD oil product, they will tell you the experience is very, very different, and they're not using CBD oil products recreationally. They're using it for symptom control.
Do we know neurologically any long-term effects of cannabis oil? Are there any long-term studies that have shown whether this affects particularly long-term brain development in children?
I can't speak to the childhood development, and no CBD oil, there's not been any long-term side effects with high usage, and there was a study that, and you'd have to go back and look at the specifics of the study, but with high usage of recreational marijuana, these were daily users of recreational marijuana. There was one study that looked at some long-term atrophy of the amygdala, the part of the temporal lobes. It wasn't shown to be associated with any clinical effect, but obviously brain atrophy would not be a good thing. But again, this would be with high usage of recreational amounts of whole plant product.
So the cannabis oil, you don't think, in your opinion, is addictive, and you don't have the problems with brain atrophy?
Correct. No, no, and no.
I mean, as a practical matter, in order for someone to become addictive, especially cannabis, I mean, the oil, wouldn't the amount ingested have to get to a certain level in order for that process to occur? As a practical matter, from what I think I know about the oil, that would make someone convulsively ill, wouldn't it?
I think that in general that's true. And the other pharmacologic effect, when you look at drugs that tend to have high addictive potential, whether they're recreational or prescription drugs, they tend to be drugs that cross the blood-brain barrier very, very quickly and get out very quickly. So if you look at methamphetamine, crack cocaine, these all get in and get out. When you look at CBD oil, because it's ingested, that's not to say it's something ingested like OxyContin, it could be addictive, obviously, but CBD oil tends to cross the blood-brain barrier fairly slowly. We think of CBD oil and spasticity management maybe as more of a maintenance therapy than an acute management therapy. If someone were having a horrible spasm right now, and we gave them CBD oil, we probably wouldn't see an effect in terms of relaxing that for about an hour.
I see it.
But you're saying you would see an effect.
We would see an effect, correct.
We have no further questions.
Thank you
for taking the time to be here today.
Thank you.
I appreciate it very much. Appreciate the witnesses doing their best on the time. Thank you.
And I'll again try to be brief as well. My name is Dr. Perrin Chaita. I'm a family medicine trained physician, Representative Golick in your district, live in Vinings, Smyrna area. I went to school in Campbell High, then went to the University of Florida, and then I did my family medicine training in San Diego, and then my palliative medicine and hospice fellowship in LA. And I'd like to tell everyone in the room a story that happened about seven, eight months ago, I was called to a patient's room. She was 44 years old, and she was dying of what we could only figure out was gut dysmotility, which means her bowels were simply not moving. And it was too painful to eat. So painful, in fact, that she needed IV medicine for nutrition. And it just got too hard. She was in and out of the hospital, in and out of the hospital, and by the time I saw her, she was done. And I sat with her and her husband, and I asked her, do you want to continue like this? And she said no. And I sat there and I saw her tell her husband that she was okay with dying because it was simply too painful to eat, and she couldn't do it anymore. And during my conversation, I asked her, is there anything that helps your symptoms? And she said, well, doc, there is one thing, but I don't know if I'm allowed to tell you. I'm like, you can tell me anything. And she said, well, smoking marijuana. Can I smoke marijuana when I go on hospice? And I said, my dear, you can smoke as much as you want. Well, imagine my surprise 2 months later, my nurse practitioner says, you won't believe who's in the hospital looking for you. And I go and she's out there smiling at me saying, look at me, I'm okay. And I said, what happened? She said, I smoked marijuana. She had gained 20 pounds since the time that I had seen her. And I had sent her home to die. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that as a hospice and palliative care physician, I deal with patients and families at the end of their lives. It's hard. It's always going to be hard. It doesn't make much sense to me to limit a potential therapeutic benefit for them. Because what if they want to spend some more quality time with their family, but they want their pain control? I'm the guy who writes morphine, Percocet, oxycodone, OxyContin, methadone, fentanyl. I know how these things work. I also know they have terrible side effects for folks. Some people, it's sleepiness. I tell folks that my goal is never to hurry anything up. It's always to use the lowest amount of medication to achieve good symptom control and avoid side effects. And mainly the side effects we're talking about is sleepiness. Now, if you'll allow me, I train in California. It's quite different out there. And I used to take care of patients in clinic that I would see for months. And I would be prescribing them opiates on a regular basis. And there were quite a few that I would talk to, and I noticed, wow, your opiates have gone down. What's going on? Is your pain better controlled? They're like, yes, because I'm using marijuana. I'm asking this group to allow me the tools that I need to take care of people. Because every single person in this room and your family members have the potential to be my patients. So, thank you. I'll take questions. And there were some things out here, so I'd love to educate folks. And if there's one thing, it was on the pharmacokinetics of cannabis oil and other medicines, and how long does it stay in your system. How long things stay in your system is a very complex question to answer. It involves how the medication was delivered. Was it orally? Was it through the mucosa? Was it intravenously? Was it in another way or subcutaneously? Those are all going to determine different rates of absorption. In addition to that, the actual pharmacology of the medication. So methadone stays in your system a really long time, like really, really long. Xanax does not. Or more IV morphine does not. So I think it would be too challenging to try to fit this into, is cannabis oil addictive? To my experience, it has not been. And I'm the one that sees people using it.
Gosh. First of all, thank you for being here, and thank you for what you do. it's got to be incredibly difficult. You look so young and happy and cheerful. You got a really tough job. I really appreciate that. Thank you very, very much. Just the practical realities of the use of the oil in hospice care. I mean, you were talking, and the people they were smoking marijuana, correct? Mm-hmm. And the results.
And oil.
I'm sorry?
And oil. All different forms in California.
Oh, okay.
Wax, oil,
so, I mean,
smoking.
I guess with the oil that, under the contemplation of, and the protocol that we have set up in current law, would the oil have, and under the category that some relief is better than nothing, certainly, and just thinking in terms of those in hospice care,
I think they're
the first that you would think of that, you know, could benefit. The practical matter is, as a practitioner, would they benefit from the oil that...
Yes, it's just a matter of figuring out how to use it, honestly. And it's not difficult. I mean, we do medication management. That's what we're trained to do. So that's not a concern of mine.
Okay.
And to the other point, there was another point about the hospice part. To be considered a hospice patient, a physician like me has to certify that you have 6 months or less to live. That's a federal guideline. And it works right now because they're not everyone is a hospice patient. I get consulted on people and they ask me, well, we want to send them to hospice, and I say, I'm sorry, I'm just not seeing it. And so therefore, it's on each individual physician who certifies if folks have 6 months left to live. And then each individual hospice company has to go review that every 3 months. And so there is a large review process when it comes to, are these patients appropriate for hospice? And if they are, well, it doesn't make much sense to me to limit what they can use.
Mr. Grubb.
Thank you, Doctor. I would like to record reflect Campbell High School continues to create wonderful students. Go Spartans. In your medical opinion, if you had a patient that was diagnosed with one of the diagnoses here on the list that we currently have, and you knew there was a medication out there that could help that patient, in your medical opinion, do you believe it would be the right thing or the wrong thing to withhold that until severe end stage? If you knew before they got to that point, the medication could help them.
Not to me, not to my ethics. You know, when we take an oath. We take an oath first as do no harm, but we take an oath to help people. And it doesn't make sense to me because there's a lot of things that help people. And not everything works for everyone. I'm not saying cannabis is a panacea. But if it helped one person, because you don't know what it's like to live with a condition, unless you're that person. And I appreciate the comments from our other physician here about MS. It is ridiculously challenging at times. I don't think it's right even to withhold a potential therapeutic drug from any patient.
Thank you. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.
One more, Dr. Hodge.
Good afternoon, Chairman and Committee. My name is Dr. Rashawn Hodge. I've been I'm also a hospice palliative care physician, family medicine trained.
What? Doctor, lift up the microphone.
Sorry. There you go.
All of honor conveniences.
I have a bad neck. Okay. Well, I'm family medicine trained at Morehouse School of Medicine. I've been working with chronic pain management for over 10 plus years, and I'm here to talk about intractable pain. So how chronic pain doctors, palliative care doctors describe chronic pain is pain that is lasting for 6 months and you have been on opiate therapy for about 6 months. We have patients in our clinic are mandated to have an MRI every year and they must be a Georgia resident. Now, I'm one of the docs as well that, you know, prescribe opiates because these patients are at a tail end. They have failed surgeries, failed laminectomies. It's not just patients that have, you know, broken bones or discs that are on spinal cords. It's patients that have an unfortunate amputation of a leg or arm, and they have a phantom limb pain. And that's something that does not respond to opiates. They pull the response to pretty much everything that's out there available. I mean, it's very difficult to treat chronic pain.
Right, Doc?
Incredibly.
Yeah, so currently we have over 100 million Americans that have chronic pain. That's over a third of our population that's dealing with intractable pain. And, you know, just to echo the study at the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, you know, medicinal cannabis is an effective treatment for intractable pain. And it also is an effective treatment for nausea from chemotherapy. So that study just came out January, and three physicians have just explored and shredded that article, and it's true, it's helping people. So I currently register patients for medicinal cannabis as well. I started a petition in my practice in October, and over a third of my patients are willing to get off their opiates if medicinal cannabis was for intractable pain. And, you know, there's zero deaths from medicinal cannabis. Opiates, you know, as we said, 30,000 last year, people dying with opiates.
Doctor, one of the concerns that has been expressed to me, and I think to others, is just the, when we talk about intractable pain, there's a concern that that's a pretty broad term, and that it has, it's potentially ripe for abuse. Can you speak to that? I'm not stating that that's necessarily my opinion, but I know that's an issue, and so you're a medical professional. How do we, if we were to go down that road, how do we get to a comfortable place where we, that would not be big enough to, you know, potentially exploit?
We can,
in practical terms,
follow the parameters for set by the medical board of Georgia, that, you know, their definition of chronic pain is, you know, which chronic pain doctors have to apply every 2 years to the medical board of Georgia, you know, so we can identify patients which, you know, are given to us by orthopedic pediatricians, neurologists, immunologists. You know, these people, these are patients that unfortunately none of the conventional treatments or therapies have not helped them for a period of 6 months. So we all know opiates cause physical dependence. You know, cannabis does not cause physical dependence. That doesn't mean it's physical dependence and addiction are totally different, you know, and physical dependence can happen after a day of being on opiates. So, question, sorry.
Mr. Strickland.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Doctor, as far as with chronic pain and your clients, what level of THC would you need to address that? We're looking at low THC oil, current law. Is that what you could give to your clients to address chronic pain, or are you talking about something higher?
Well, we had to start with our law, but eventually, you know, different methods of delivery, you know, vaporization, ingesting it, suppositories, because a lot of patients, you know, with chronic pain, they might have an issue that they have dysphagia, they have difficulty swallowing. So that patient has difficulty swallowing, or at the end of life, you know, you might be obtunded, you might be, your level of consciousness is not, you know, you have to be pretty alert to swallow. You got to protect your airway. But that's not always the case for patients that with severe autism or chronic pain or injury, you know, or a physical debility where they can't really swallow, or they might be on feeding tubes where they need other delivery methods of cannabis, medicinal cannabis, and that could be using their rectum, a suppository. That rectal vein works better than swallowing pills.
Correct.
So different delivery methods will help. And of course, different levels of THC, the CBD ratios are definitely needed to treat intractable pain. It is not, everyone in my clinic is not coming in for opiates. You know, it might be someone, you know, the fastest growing population is baby boomers, you know, until a couple of years ago. Now, we all know someone that's gonna, in their 60s, is, you know, that's gonna get a herpes zoster or shingle outbreak. We all heard of shingles?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a third of people with shingles are gonna have post-herpetic neuralgia. It will never go away. I mean, their leg was always going to feel like it's on fire. And those patients don't need opiates. They need medicinal cannabis or something that's non-addicting to treat them. You know?
One follow-up question. If we were to add the chronic pain to the condition of the current law, that could get the low THC oil as defined in the current law, would it actually have an impact on your patients, the current low THC level?
It would be an immediate impact because most patients with chronic pain, there's also a myriad of problems. They have depression. You know, these patients miss their life every second of the day. They miss their own life, you know? So chronic pain causes depression. There's nothing in the future for them. There's no other available treatments. And we all know opiates are being tabled, so there's anxiety. Medicinal cannabis is one going to help with some, even a low dose will help with muscle spasms. It will elevate their mood, you know? So maybe they'll eat a little more. They gain a little more weight. There's been studies that medicinal cannabis with opiates, you take less opiates, it works synergistically together, that you require less opiates. And taking the oil sublingual can kind of break that habit of stuff in your mouth with pills. And that's a habit in itself too, you know? Hurt, grab a pill. So this is a different, safer, again, zero deaths, and it's gonna benefit a lot of Georgians.
Our current maximum percentage is 5%, which is one of the highest in the nation, if not the highest.
No, it's not.
That in and of itself, from just a pure potency standpoint, from what you see, what you do, I'm assuming that's high enough. It's well within what could be necessary.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But to explore higher levels, will, you know, at different ratios, would be very beneficial as well, because
we're fighting, you know, just to keep the 5.
It's chronic pain is very personal. You know, everyone's going to react differently. It depends on, you know, support at home, how many kids you have, what kind of job you have. It's not everyone has the luxury of just twiddling their thumbs when they break a neck, or, you know, people have to get out there and work. It's the number one cause of disability, and it's chronic pain is bigger than heart disease, diabetes, and cancer. I mean, it cost our country that more, way more money than those three combined.
Mr. Bode.
Yes. Doctor, you may be able to answer this question. Actually, I have two questions. I see that we have post-traumatic syndrome on the list. However, when I was looking through the slide notes, and you may be able to answer this question, that it stated that depression is not affected by cannabis oil, but I see post-traumatic syndrome is. Why is that? What is the difference?
We're talking about post-traumatic stress disorder,
yes,
PTSD.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Well, PTSD is a problem, you know, a big, huge problem. You know, every 70 minutes, a veteran commits suicide. That's 20 suicides a day. And that's since 2011, that's been reported. They have horrific night terrors. And if anyone's been, you never slept in a couple days, it's worse than being hungry. I mean, you're irritable, you know, you lose your natural hormones that come out when you sleep, which protect you. That's the importance of sleep. You know, they decrease the cortisol, the bad stuff, so that the feel-good hormones like the epinephrine, the dopamine come out. So if you're lacking sleep for a couple of days, imagine for a couple of weeks what's going to happen to you. You get severely depressed. I mean, you lose everything. So with medicinal cannabis, It helps with sleep onset, so that time when you're rolling around, you know, it might feel like 15, 20 minutes, it might be 5 minutes. It helps with sleep duration, so, you know, if you have severe muscle spasms, you have night terrors, you know, those will wake you up, your back tightening. You know, sometimes you might be able to get a full 6 hours, but your back woke you up, or your neck woke you up. That happens all the time. So medicinal cannabis is going to help with that sleep duration because you're having less spasms. So you're getting all that restorative hormones and what your body's, you know, that feel-good hormones and how your body cleans itself up when it sleeps, it's doing its job. So medicinal cannabis can helpfully, successfully treat PTSD because these patients are finally going to sleep. And what they really need is just sleep, you know.
Mr. Chairman, I have one follow-up question. Now, in regards to sickle cell, now, does the medical cannabis oil help with the pain associated with sickle cell, or does it help with keeping the cells from sickle?
The cells are already sickled,
okay.
You know, and this is a mutation, you know, in West Africa, which actually kept people alive. You know, where countries in the Mediterranean, you know, malaria was is killing people, thousands. So people with that mutation survived, and there goes the disease, right? So the cells are already sickle, that's the first part. Two, people with sickle cell, when they get into crises. Now this crisis is when those, if the cell is round, they just normally go down the highway, which is your arteries, no problem, no accidents. But the actual shape has changed, so they kind of, they back up, you know, like say Spaghetti Junction, they'll just back all the way up, and guess what? Red blood cells carry oxygen. So, that is, imagine, you know, we all watch TV, and someone has a heart attack, they grab their chest, and because that their heart is not having oxygen, there's a clogged artery, so it's very painful. Now, imagine that's your whole extremity, you know, or that's your spleen, you know, or that's your lower leg, or that's your liver, you know, or it's some part in your brain, you're gonna have a stroke, you have heart attacks. So during that acute pain crisis, medicinal cannabis will help, you know, get people off opiates, because unfortunately, that's what you have to treat sickle cell crisis is with a lot of opiates. But as far as maintenance, you know, if a sickle cell patient takes their medicinal cannabis more as a treatment and as a regimen, you're gonna take one less opiates. And one of the best side effects of medicinal cannabis is you get a little thirsty. It's hydration. And sickle cell crisis, a big problem is a dehydration problem. So that's why we instruct sickle cell patients, first thing you wake up, drink a glass of water. Yeah. So that would help, you know, one, the side effects of medicinal cannabis, which is you might get a little lethargic, you know, they need sleep, they need rest. You know, another great side effect is you're thirsty, you're gonna drink more water, and that keeps them out of crisis. And they're taking less opiates, taking less hydroxyurea, you know, it's less physical dependence.
Thank you, Doc.
Okay, Vice Chair. Thank you, Doctor. You were talking a minute ago about the PTSD and specifically with the sleep issue, and I know earlier today at Dr. Bradford, I believe his presentation talked about how the conclusive evidence on medical cannabis is with some sleep issues. And so my question is simple. There's obviously no shortage of sleep aids that are available, some by over-the-counter and some by prescription. So I'll just ask you, since you were talking about PTSD, why THC oil to help in sleep versus a prescription for something such as Ambien or a number of different medications that are designed for sleep aid?
Okay, Ambien, every sleep aid is only for temporary sleep issues. There's no safe long-term sleep aids. So you brought up Ambien. Ambien is only indicated for 3 or 4 days. But unfortunately, it's written for a dirty amount every night. That causes severe, you know, that's a benzodiazepine, just in the same class like a Xanax or Ativan, that causes severe addiction. You know, it's severe physical dependence with Ambien. So there are no safe alternatives for sleep. I mean, there's Benadryl, but not everyone can take Benadryl. And the only reason why Benadryl is indicated for sleep, because the side effect of Benadryl, a couple of folks say, hey, you know what, when I take Benadryl, I get a little lethargic. And so the, you know, the drug company says, okay, that's one of the indications. So there are no safe alternatives for sleep. And, you know, I know that I don't write it in my practice. I don't combine sleep aids with opiates. You know, that's a dangerous cocktail that causes a lot of deaths. You know, it's not just the opiates that are killing people. It's an opiate with a benzo. You know, people forget what they took. They wake up in the middle of the night, the Ambien is supposed to keep them asleep for 6 hours, or wake up 2 hours later, and take another Ambien. All right? Now, those work synergistically in a negative way.
Sure. Okay, thank you.
Doctor, we need to move on. Thanks very much for your time and testimony today. Appreciate it. Speaker, you wrapped up, right? Okay. We'll now move to the opponent's side. Let me ask you, we have some preset witnesses.